mentored by the famous Disney Nine Old Men's member Frank Thomas, Holly Johnston, and Eric Larson. He animated on the feature film The Rescuers, Pete's Dragon, Fox and Hound, mostly the stunning sequence with the fighting bear. He created and animated one of the most popular characters, such as the Little Mermaid Ariel, the Beast, Pocahontas, Tarzan, and Rapunzel. In 2012, he decided it was time to create his own company to explore other aspects of animation, and Glen Keane Productions' first project was made with Google to create.
Since I was here, and I really am thankful to Annecy. It was here that I met my two heroes of animation, Frederick Bach and Hayao Miyazaki, 25 years ago, and just wonderful things happened. Most of the meetings happened somewhere between the palace down there and here, on that nice long walk. There's something about animation that it's just continuing to evolve and change. And I want to talk about that evolving face of animation. In 1972, when I started at CalArts, portfolio was sent there by accident to the wrong school and found myself in animation. And I was wondering, what in the world did I get myself into? But then I was seeing these Disney films, and I thought, that's what I want to do. I want to do something like that. And they said, look, don't even try for Disney. It's a dead art form. I mean, it's just pretty much over. So, you know, look for something else that you can actually do. You know, those kind of statements, anytime somebody's predicting the future, you can be sure it's not going to be that. So today, I want to talk about that. I want to talk about how do you, in this ever-changing pace of animation, how do you keep your passion? That the character exists before I've animated them, before I've designed them. So it's a very strange thing, and I never would have said that before, except that's been my experience. And like with the Beast, I remember one of my assistants came in and said, so what's the Beast gonna look like? I said, I don't know. And it'd been 6 months, I'd been doing all kinds of designs, but it wasn't, none of them were him. And I said, I don't know, I kind of like this buffalo-like head. There's sort of a sadness to this buffalo shape. Maybe it was because the buffalo head was on my wall and that's why he looked sad. I don't know, but there's the brow of the gorilla. And there's a combination of animals. I was explaining to him as he was standing over my shoulder, I was doing this drawing just like this. I said, I kind of like the muzzle of this wild boar with the tusks and I'm drawing this, I'm thinking, oh, Belle's never going to fall in love with this guy. How's this going to work? But I don't know, there's something about this that seems to be good. Maybe I'll give him a mane of a lion, like that. And I like the beard of this buffalo. Maybe a bear-like body, his shoulders are stolen off. And maybe, let's see. These horns. I had a whole combination of different horns I'd been studying, and it could be like that. And I'm thinking, oh man, no way Belle's gonna fall in love with this guy. I'll make him a little softer. I'll give him cow ears. That kind of makes him a little friendlier. And inside is this prince. That he's trapped inside, and he's looking out from inside the body of this beast. And as I drew it, just as fast as I just did it there, I said, that's him. There he is. And it's like you recognize, and I knew that was him.
And that's been the experience on each of the characters that I've designed, that there's this moment where it all comes together and you realize that's them.
So I like to live in the skin of the characters that I create. When I was animating the Beast, my jaw would hurt. I'd come home and I'd talk to Linda. I said, I don't know, I got some problem with my jaw. I don't know what it is. But the whole time I'm animating, I'm doing that, it's looking like the Beast, you know. When I was little, I had a temper, a bad temper. And I would throw stuff around in my room, and it'd be like, I was like a little beast. That's what I was animating when I was animating the Beast. My mom, I remember her coming down the hallway. As I'd be throwing some tantrums, she'd say, is that my little Glenny? She was Australian, so she had that wonderful, it made me even madder, you know. So I animated that frustration with the Beast. And, you know, you can see me in that face there. You know, that's me. There I am. And it's always entertaining to watch somebody try to do what's impossible, like for Beast to control his temper. Let's take a look. Whoops.
Straighten up, hard work like a gentleman.
Ah, yes, when she comes in, give her a dashing, debonair smile. Come, show me the smile.
But don't frighten the poor girl.
Impress her with your rapier wit.
But be gentle.
Shower her with compliments.
But be sincere.
And above all, you must control your temper. Here she is.
Good
evening.
Well, where is she?
Hello. The girl. Yes, the girl. Well, actually, she's in the process of... circumstances being what they are, she's not coming.
What?
No, wait! Stop it!
I thought I told you to come down to dinner.
I'm not hungry.
You come out or I'll break down the door.
Master, I could be wrong, but that may not be the best way to win the girl's affections.
Needs attempt to be a gentleman,
but she is being so difficult.
Gently.
Will you come down to dinner?
No.
Suave, genteel.
It would give me great pleasure if you would join me for dinner. Please.
No, thank you.
You can't stay in there forever.
Yes, I can.
Fine. Then go ahead and starve! If she doesn't eat with me, then she doesn't eat at all.
Oh dear, that didn't go very well at all, did it?
So I always have this image in any talk that I give, because it illustrates creativity in the best way to me. I mean, here's four different people. They're all using the same materials, these four builders. And one of them has put it together in a way that no one ever thought. And the other three are there looking at it, and I always think they're saying, now why didn't I think of that? And creativity is like that. There's sort of a fear out of doing something different. That we all have this common shared fear of us, I don't know, not really having earned our way where we are. That, you know, in a group like this, I know that the one thing we all have in common is that if the people around you knew, I mean, that the way we're thinking is that the people around us knew how much we're faking it, that we'd be booted out of here. But that's because there's a humility to being an animator, to being an artist. You know that you could just do so much better if you just had a little more time. And that never goes away. I mean, that's always how it's been. It takes courage to keep moving forward. Fear is the thing that we overcome. Now, my dad,
was a fearless artist in a lot of ways. This was our house in Arizona. He moved seven of us and our family all out into the desert with him. My mom and him and the five kids. No job, just his ability to draw cartoons. And that's what he did. He created the family circus, a comic based on his own family. That's me over on the left-hand side there. Dad was, you know, constantly drawing all of us. That's me at 5 years old. One of his cartoons drew the things that happened in the home. Dad was like a big kid. I mean, he would draw on the walls. If I did that, I'd get in trouble. But he could draw his face on there and draw little handprints. I mean, he was just like a kid. When he passed away, we were selling his house, and my wife Linda and I wanted to take a picture of the bar there. I mean, not because the bar was so special, but I remembered crawling under the bar. And if you crawled under the bar, you would see that Dad had been there ahead of you, and he'd thrown this, "All right, wise guy, get out from under the bar." Like, I mean, who thinks that way? I mean, you've got to be like a little kid. Okay, if the kids are going to crawl under there and look up, and this guy's going to be yelling at them. That's the most important thing, that you never want to let go of that childlike thinking. My granddaughter Matisse, and she's drawing. She just crawls into the world that she's drawing. She's completely lost in that drawing. The secret to her creativity is either in the milk bottle or the glass of Merlot. I'm not sure which one of those it is. But there was a teacher, he taught at a university, and his little girl said, she was 6 years old, said, "Daddy, where do you go all day?" And he was an art teacher. He said, "Well, sweetheart, I teach big people how to draw." And she said, "Oh, you mean they forget?" Yeah. When I was little, we'd say, "Let's play make-believe." They're just always a common thing. Let's play make-believe. Matisse is there with her little friends, dressed up as fairies, but they're not dressed up as fairies. They are fairies. I mean, it's real for them. This is the key to never letting go of that childlike quality. My mentor, Ollie Johnston, had these trains in his backyard. There's something about trains and animators. Walt Disney, Ward Kimball, Ollie Johnston, they all had trains. I mean, this is weird. In their backyard, big trains. And at the studio lot, they would get together at night and be working on their trains. I mean, there's something about trains. All the working mechanisms are on the outside. It's fascinating to see how motion works and momentum, and animators, they live in that world. It seems like there's something about trains that speak to that childlike wonder in us. My friend John Carrs visited me one day up at our home in Lake Arrowhead. I think it was around Halloween or something, but I mean, he's a tall guy. He doesn't need to be that much taller, but he came as in this costume. And there's a guy that's like a kid. He stood out in the point and waved to the tour boat as it went by. All the tourists, "What in the world is that giraffe? Is that, or is that a guy? What is that?" Picasso said, "When I was young, I could draw and paint like Raphael, but it has taken me a lifetime to learn to draw like a child." To watch him draw, it's like he's having a conversation with the drawing. He's listening to it. That little squiggle there, it's like, okay, where am I? And he needs another one there. Over here. He's responding. I mean, if we can have a conversation with our art like that, so it just is so natural. I mean, that's the key. drawing. I mean, because of drawing, coming up against the computer, where there's this moment where people were saying, well, you know, you got to choose. Are you going to draw or are you going to use a computer? What do you like to do? Like, well, don't make me choose that. Oh, well, you got to choose because we're not going to do hand-drawn animation anymore. Well, I don't believe it. I just don't believe it. There's got to be a place for drawing. And if I'm going to fight for that, then what is drawing? I started asking myself that question. Like, what do I look at when I draw? Like, if you're doing a drawing, what do you actually look at? I noticed that as I drew, I thought I was looking at my line when I drew, but I'm not. I was looking just a little to the right of the line, or to the left, but it was always about, the line was creating the invisible form within it. And and I realized, you know, drawing is really about sculpting. It's like sculptural drawing. That's what I love. Michelangelo said, design, or as it is called by another name, drawing, constitutes the fountainhead and substance of painting and sculpture and architecture and is the root of all sciences. Let him who has attained the possession of this be assured that he possesses a great treasure. I mean, drawing is pretty amazing. You've got this pencil. Now, when we were working on Duet, I saw a sign up there in Saratoga that said, simplicity is the ultimate sophistication. Like, oh, I like that. Simplicity is the ultimate sophistication. Like, that is the most sophisticated tool you can find. It's a straight line makes a mark on the end, straight into your hand where you can hold it. It runs down your arm into your heart where there's something hidden that others can't see. And it comes out right up to the point where you can communicate it. It's like, I love this tool. Why do I want to give that up? I'm going to hang on to a tool like that. Whether it's any kind of an artistic expression, whether it's writing or painting or music, you are taking something inside and communicating it to others. When I was a kid, around Christmas time, they would have me do these big drawings on the blackboard, and this was a big day for me. I'll never forget that because I didn't draw to do a drawing. I did a drawing to make the paper go away so I could step into the drawing. And as I'm drawing the hay on the stable roof, my hand is reaching into space because I had drawn those sheep in the foreground. And I know they look like hamsters, but those are sheep. And as I was drawing that, my hand was going like 50 feet into space, and I felt it. I could feel those sheep were behind me, and I was drawing here. And I was now in that space. And that's this desire that I've always had in my animation. I want to do that sculptural drawing. I want to live in the space. And that really just led me on this journey that I was on. Ultimately, I got to Disney. This is the Disney studio there. It's interesting, those trees, the trees around that animation building are cork trees given to Walt Disney by the King of Spain when they did Ferdinand the Bull. And he knew that Walt was building the studio, and so he sent them there, and there's these beautiful trees are all around the studio. The squirrels run up and down them. It was a dream-like place. I mean, I never dreamed that I could work there. But there I was. And I had all these drawings that I'd been working on so hard to convince Disney. And I showed them to Eric Larson, my mentor. And as he went through the portfolio, he's going faster and faster. Well, I spent 6 months on that drawing. And he got to one drawing, and he looked at it. And it was this drawing that I knew I shouldn't have put it in there. It was just a really quick little sketch figure drawing, and it just didn't look like I really was, I don't know, it's just too simple and everything. So Eric went to the end, as if he found nothing, and he went back to this drawing. He said, can you do more like this? I said, well, yeah, I mean, that took like 6 seconds. If you can do more like that, maybe there's a place for you. I'm thinking, yeah, but I didn't even work at that. That was like a gift. It just, boom, it was there. So that's where I really started on this path of expressing myself in my drawings. And in The Fox and the Hound, I was animating or was drawing this bear fight. And I was trying to really capture the energy in the line of those drawings. There was this charcoal. I couldn't draw the bear big enough. He had to be black and covering the whole screen. And the charcoal made you feel the softness of the fur. And as I was working on that, I really wanted somehow to preserve that. Now, at that time at Disney, they did not keep the original drawings. At one point, one of the guys in management came in on a cart into my office and started loading up all of my bear fight drawings and Fox and Hound. And I said, oh, where are you going with that? He said, well, we're going to shred them. And he was going, and I said, whoa, what are you going to, what, shred? And he said, yeah, you mean like cut them up and destroy them? Yeah, it's just like there's too many drawings like that. And it doesn't really matter anyway, because what matters is the final film. And I realized, this is not the way I feel. It's like it never gets better than the moment that I animated and acted it out on the table. No. So I grabbed all of that stuff and I started keeping it in my garage. And it wasn't until The Little Mermaid that Disney actually started to keep the rough drawings. And it may not even have been The Little Mermaid. I don't know, because I didn't let them have any of that stuff. I kept it all. Until when I left Disney, then I gave all of that back, and now it's all in archives. But I wanted somehow to capture that. And so I talked to, of Iwerks' son, Don Iwerks. He was head of research at Disney. I said, Don, is there some way for us to animate in charcoal? And he said, you know, maybe there is. Well, here's a photographic process, I'm thinking, and it's on cells, because we still had to paint the cells, but we could photograph the charcoal drawings and put it onto a cell. This is going to be, we could do this. And I was so excited, we were doing a test on it, and then management said, no, this is, it's way too much work. And I was so disappointed, and, you know, my dream was dying. Now, what do you do when your creative dream disappears? We all face it. There's a moment where everything you hope for just poof goes away. And I think of it now instead of the way I did then, which was, okay, it's over, it's done, it's never going to happen. But when I look at my life, I realize, no, those ideas, they just go underground. It's like a river underground, that as you are moving through your life, that those dreams and desires are still traveling with you. They're just you can't see them, but they're there. They're not going away. And one point, they will come back up again. We had this multiplane camera there at the studio, and on The Fox and the Hound, we could have one multiplane shot, where in Bambi you had so many wonderful multiplane shots where the camera was moving through the forest, but now we got one. I was like, that's just not fair. Well, one day John Lasseter and I went across the street. They were working on Tron in the theater there, and we saw these light cycles moving in Z space. And they were all like multiplane shots. And we came back to my office and was like, all right, we've got to figure out how we're going to do this together. So we started working on this little animation test from where the wild things are, where we would animate the characters by hand and do the computer animation of the walls and all of that. And that was out in New York. That studio became Blue Sky that was doing this. Chris Wedge was working with us at that point. And I mean, this is all very crude, but I gotta say that when I was animating this and the backgrounds were moving, suddenly it was that, well, I was that little kid drawing in space now, but it was real, and it was all happening. And I mean, it was like John and I heard the angels singing, this, here's the future, this is it. We were so excited showing it to management and what was this was going to really be an incredible future for us. But it ended up, they said, no. Matter of fact, John, you're fired. So John Lasseter left. I don't know what happened to that guy. And I went on to continue to animate, and that river went underground. But I love characters that believe the impossible is possible. I hang on to that in my personal life. This is who I am, and I guess there's no one that relates more to that than Ariel. I mean, she lives underwater. She's got fins, but she falls in love with a guy that's got feet and breathes air. I mean, this is not going to work, but that's not gonna stop her. And there's this one moment in Part of Your World where Ariel is singing, and she reaches out and she wants to touch that world that is impossible. And I'm a 33-year-old guy, and I'm animating this 16-year-old mermaid, and you know, I'm trying to be cool and all that, but I am a mermaid now. And Ariel is swimming up, and I can tell that she wants to do something like really cheesy and reach right out to the audience with these big, huge eyes, and then drift back down. And it's like, okay, I'm not going to do that. Everybody will know what a sentimental guy I am. And, but I couldn't stop Ariel. She did it anyway. So I'm just going to show you a short little clip of that in the rough animation. I mean, this is the way I would animate after I do my tie down, so they look a little bit like that. But before that, the drawings look like this. Because, I mean, these are gribouillé scribbles of... I think of drawing as... the lines we make are like a seismograph of your soul. They're registering something emotional as you're putting it down. So here's this little clip.
To spend a day warm on the sand, that John led, they understand that they don't reprimand their daughters. Bring young women, sick of swimming, ready to stand. Questions and get some answers. What's a fire and why does it? What's the word? Burn. When's it my turn? Wouldn't I love to explore that shore of a bow out of the sea? Wish I could be.
That was from a crummy VHS tape. That was really advanced technology back then.
And years later, I was speaking at Cal Arts, and one of the students came up to me and said, Mr. Keane, I got to talk to you. I said, yeah, what is it? Well, there's this moment in Little Mermaid where Ariel, in part of your world, is swimming and reaching out. I don't know if you remember, but she's like reaching right out for the audience. And I said, oh, yeah, I remember that. He said, well, I was 4 years old, and I was in that movie theater. And when that moment came on, I stood up, and I reached out to take her hands so that I could bring her in where I was because she wanted to be part of my world. Thank you, I could kiss you. This was to connect with your audience. When you are vulnerable, when you put your own feelings out there and you go, you know, I'm not going to listen to that voice in my head that says, don't do that. It's going to be cheesy. Everybody's going to know something more about you than you want them to know. That means you should do that very thing. That's the part of you that you need to open up as an artist. And it's been that way for me all the way along. The very best things, it seemed to me, in life and creativity are often the things that you don't work for, but the things that you are given. They're like a gift. They're just there. And you just have to be ready to find them and pick them up. That happened for me on Aladdin. I was working on Aladdin, and we were going to roll right from Aladdin right into Pocahontas, and somewhere in doing this drawing of Aladdin, I started thinking about Pocahontas. And maybe it was the way I was drawing the angles of Aladdin's eyes or his mouth shape. There was something triangular there, and something in my head said, Superman's shield. Superman's shield. And I was like, yeah, that's Pocahontas' face. I've been looking at American Indian faces and Asian faces, and they had this Superman shield face. And so I started to draw Pocahontas, but it happened to be on the same animation page as Aladdin. And the more I got into that, Nick Ranieri, one of the animators, came in and said, what are you doing? I said, well, I'm thinking that this should be Pocahontas, should be based on a different kind of a design. And so I did that. That's a little, I erased it, but you can still see the Superman shield up there. And Nick said, oh, so that's really cool. Okay, it's approved. And he wrote Nick on there. And also you can see JK for Jeffrey Katzenberg, that was going to be approved for the future. But now I didn't know what I was going to do. I had to, now I've got Pocahontas on this drawing here. And so I just redrew Aladdin. Now that drawing exists over in archives. And, you know, there's a certain point, though, where the river that has gone underground reappears. And that happened for me on Tarzan with that CG animation coming back up. And suddenly now I could be animating in this space again. And there I was living the same experience as John and I on doing Where the Wild Things Are. This is the first test of animating Tarzan using deep canvas. And the drawing on charcoal for Pocahontas, there's this moment suddenly where, because we were no longer on cells, Pocahontas in Colors of the Wind, I animated a moment in charcoal. Have you ever heard a wolf cry to the poor moon? Or asked the grinning wildcat why he grinned? Can you sing with all the voices of a mountain? Can you paint with all the colors of the wind? Can you paint with all the colors of the wind? Thank you.
last week I was at Disney Archives, or 2 weeks ago, and there's going to be a show in San Francisco at the Disney Museum of my animation, and so I was selecting some animation, and there was, they had all those charcoal drawings nicely preserved, and there's like all kinds of these wonderful memories that were coming back as I was looking through these drawings. And I remembered when they came into my office to take the drawings that from Tangled to the archives, and I was giving them to them, and I've got my regular grubby blackened hands graphite, and I'm taking those drawings and giving them, and they've got white gloves, and they're taking them, and I saw one of the drawings. It's like, oh, it just needed to be finished. I said, let me take back. No. You need your gloves now. It's like, what? What do you mean? Well, you know, now it's with archives. It's like the drawing died and went to heaven. It's like, he can't be with you anymore. Hey. But I'm really thankful that there are people that care about this, the artwork, the original drawings like that. On Rapunzel, Ollie Johnston, I talked to Ollie about this and this movie, and he wrote this little note up there in his shaky hand because he couldn't really write or draw anymore. And he said, Glenn, I hope you get to make this film. And I kept that on my desk while we were working on that movie. I mean, it took 16 years from when I started it while I was working on Tarzan to where it actually got done. Part of the challenge on that, Michael Eisner was saying, well, I want you to do it in CG. So, well, Michael, do you like all the drawings I'm doing? I love them. Well, you can't do that in CG. Well, there's got to be a way you can take what you love in drawing and put it into CG. And it was such a naive thing to say, but something pure about that. So I said, okay, let's do it. And so we started to work at the studio, and there was, in dailies, we had the Cintiq where I could draw over people's drawings. And my friend John Kars was sitting next to me because he was supervising animation along with me, and apparently he was filming me. I didn't know, but I make a lot of stupid faces when I draw. But it was really wonderful because the animators could see the drawings up on the screen, and they would have those drawings at their desk waiting for them. And it was a way to try to bring the feeling, the emotions that you're getting in drawing. And Rapunzel was quite a challenge because she's got 30 feet of hair. One thing that you can't animate very well is hair, especially if it's long. And the effects guys were saying, you know, it would really help if you don't have Rapunzel touch her hair. Like, what? Like, yeah, we can't really have her touch her hair because it's going to probably cause chaos and everything in her hair. Like, well, you know, every girl, if you're talking to her and she's got long hair, it's going to be twirling around her finger or something. So I did this little test, and I brought all of the tech guys, all the code people together, as well as the animator. They'd never all been in the same room before. They were completely two separate things. I said, okay, we all have to embrace this problem together, but this girl and her hair are one. So I just did this little piece of animation to show Rapunzel how she walks and tosses her hair, and, you know, I mean, I know I was causing a heart attack for all of the effects guys, but, you know, they're saying, okay, does she really have to grab the hair with her feet, and why does she have to, like, even, you know, kick it, too? I mean, it's like, well, that's who she is. But they suddenly love the idea of solving that problem, and so that's where we started to solve the problems.
Yeah. So, what do you want?
So this is Tony Smead's animation.
What?
That's in the film. And
listen, the only thing I want to do with your hair
is to get out of it. Literally.
Wait, you don't want my hair?
Why on earth would I want your hair? Look, I was being chased, I saw a tower, I climbed, end of story.
Now, it was just like a year before that that we were still struggling, trying to figure out how to animate that hair, and it was getting that result. But eventually you solve those problems and you go through it. And I've been doing that for about 38 years at Disney, continuing. But it got to this point where I felt like there was something new, and I didn't quite know what it was. Something calling to me, I felt like, okay, I talked to my wife about maybe I should leave Disney. She said, well, what would you do? Where would you go? I don't know, like, Google? Google, what? They don't do animation. I know, I think that's why. I think I want to be places where they don't do animation. Well, because you don't want to animate? No, I do want to animate. But a company like that touches so many people, and they could be about animation as well, with something to give. And I don't know, okay, well, we'll see what happens with that. But I remembered Ollie Johnston had said early on, Glenn, someday you're going to do greater things than us. I thought, for years and years and years. I mean, he said that when I was like 25. And why did he say that? I wish he'd never said that. I mean, how are you going to do greater than Pinocchio? I mean, that's it. I mean, that's perfection there. And I'm never going to do that. And I realized after having left Disney that he wasn't talking about greater in quality, but greater in application. Take animation, take the principles that we've learned and apply it in new ways that you've never even imagined. I mean, I think that's, he didn't even know it, but that's what he was really saying. And after I left Disney, first thing that happened is Google called. And we went up there and we worked on a film that really challenged us creatively, looking at this technology at Spotlight Stories, where using GPS you could follow animation in all directions. There was no limits, no cuts any longer. I thought of this Picasso's saying, I'm always doing that which I cannot do in order that I may learn how to do it. And this was a place where we could really do that. Jenny, why don't you come on up here? I'm going to show duet with the camera, with the phone and the camera focused on it, so we can actually see how it played out. We worked together as a team. This is Rashid and his gang. And I would teach them figure drawing at night, and then they tried to teach me algorithms. They weren't very successful with that. And you started thinking of story differently. The head of ATAP, which was the group that at Google were doing this, she did this little illustration showing how this story was really about a little boy and a girl, but it was not linear, but like a double helix of two like spiral staircases intertwining. And the way we're just thinking about story was entirely different and entirely new. So Jenny was our producer on this film, as she has been on. So the quality on the phone is actually looks better than up on the screen here, but and while he's running this way, she's growing up around the other side, getting bigger. She wants to be a dancer. That's what she's dreaming of. he loves nature. Together they keep meeting. And as they meet, these moments become even more important. The dog is kind of connecting the two of them as she grows up. And Jenny gets lost. Now we can follow her as she climbs up the tree. And as she's climbing up, her name is Mia, the boy's name is Taj. He climbs up and, whoa, there they are. She sits. There's a moment there. Go up to the branches and take a look, Jenny. Now as you can go around, you can see all up in the branches. And if you get lost, we have a butterfly that comes in to lead you back. We've been waiting for you there. Trips, he catches her. And the dog is there. And, oh, he sees a squirrel. Uh-oh, what? He's ruining everything. Pulls him away, as Tosh has to go there. And then back to Mia. She is now dancing on stage as Tosh is climbing. Let's take a look at him. He's climbing. He's out in nature, up to the waterfall. And they both turn into this flock of birds and connect. And that's the dog with the longest lifespan on Earth. Is Jenny was moving anywhere she wanted at any time, and the music continued playing. How the heck did that work? I mean, to be able to weave music together so it fit like these sliding scales. Scott Stafford, who's right there, was our music. Why don't you stand up, Scott? First got there, it was like, well, this is such a tiny little screen. Why do I want to do that when I've been animating like on big screens and stuff? And this little film has been seen in so many different venues and avenues in New York City, Times Square, Christmas, in the largest screen in the world. They were playing the left there. And it was so cool just to see the animation up there in the streets of New York. And that never would have happened in just the traditional studio setting. I'm finding that there are doors that are opening in all kinds of ways that never would have opened had I not really stepped out and jumped out. And you have to make that leap, you know, to really boldly step out without the promise of what's going to happen. Because when you do, that's when everything comes together. It was at, actually, Google met Benjamin Millepied, who became the head of the Paris Opera, and he invited a group of filmmakers to come into the opera and to do films with Paris Ballet, and he asked me to do something with animation. You know, animators are basically pretty humble people. I mean, you don't feel like you could just walk into Garnier Opera. But there I was. I am drawing these dancers. I mean, I'll never forget. It's just like, I can't believe they let me in here. It felt like I'm going into the White House or something. And just drawing these dancers moving around, it was heaven for me. And so I just had this short little film. But as I was drawing the dancers, I was noticing the way they were kind of like a deer, you know, with this beautiful long neck, and there was a grace to them. And so we did this little film called Nephtali, based on Psalm 42, kind of a spiritual journey of this girl who's like a deer in a lot of ways. Marion Barbeau is the dancer at the Paris Ballet now. And so this is the little film that we did. So from going to Google or going to the Paris Ballet, and then next, felt like I was, you know, like a billiard ball just bouncing from one thing to the next, and people inviting me in to their world, asking me to be me, which was really wonderful, which I never could have predicted. Tilt Brush at Google, this wonderful way of being able to draw in VR. Recently, I've been doing some demonstrations where I'm drawing aerial with the goggles on.
Wouldn't you think I'm a girl who has everything? Look at this trove, treasures untold. How many wonders can one cavern hold? Looking around here, you think, sure, she's got everything. I've got gadgets and gizmos aplenty. I've got who's it's and what's it's galore. You want thingamabobs? I got 20. But who cares? No big deal. I want more. I want to be where the people are. I want to see them dancing, walking around on the...
So... The wonderful thing about drawing in virtual reality is the scale. First thing you realize is everything is the real size as it is in your imagination. It exists as a full-size mermaid. If you're drawing the beast, you're drawing him way up here, because it's real in your imagination. And so I was going to do a drawing of some sort using VR, and I wasn't sure what it was going to be. And I had, in years before, I was a chaperone with my daughter for my daughter's high school choir, and they went to Washington, D.C., and they won this big national competition. And so I was on the dance floor drawing everybody dancing. I was in the middle of it, and just doing these sketches. It was really wonderful, just to draw and all the energy, and one of the chaperones had a son there, and he didn't quite know how to fit in with all of that going on. But I thought, that's what I want to draw. I want to take the audience and put them in the middle of that victory dance. So I started that, to work on that with this idea. This is just what I'm seeing in my goggles.
Feeling my way through the darkness, guided by a beating heart.
Dimensional gesture drawing.
I can't tell where the journey will end, but I know where to start. They tell me I'm too young to understand. They say I'm caught up in a dream. Well, life will pass me by if I don't open up my eyes. So that's fine by me.
Now, before I do that, though, I'm drawing, this is like my training wheels moment where I'm actually trying to sculpt these. I'll do these quick little sketches, but then I was doing these sculpture drawings, filling in the forms around that so that I could then go back and draw around it so that it felt more solid. But then after a while, I didn't need to do that anymore. And that was after I had that goggles on for maybe it was 12 hours straight, just in that space drawing. And you start to see things differently. You start to think differently. So here you are on the dance floor, and all these kids are dancing around, and I could never have felt that in my sketchbook. Another, the next place called and asked for Riot Games, a video game company. This is Riot Games near Venice Beach, Culver City. One of the biggest animation companies, but we don't even know about it. Like, all those people. And their work is it's like a sport, Riot Games. And they've been creating these characters. These young guys invented 128 different characters, and they now wanted them to have more depth. Not depth visually, but depth in their characters. So they asked, would I work on this character, Lux? So I started to do these different drawings of her. Actually, I grabbed an old piece of Disney animation paper from 1940 and did this sketch of what she might look like. And so this is a girl who, she's a princess, and she has light emanating from her. Her power is light. But she lives in a culture that doesn't believe in the supernatural. They don't believe in this light. And so she struggled between embracing who she is and hiding who she is. And so I did this little piece of animation showing how can this girl lead and still possess this light. And so this is this little piece of animation that I did. So when I showed that to them there at Riot Games, they said, well, what is that? Like some new kind of animation? What is it? Like, well, it's rough pose. What's that? Well, this is the way animation looks. I've never seen anything like this. This is really cool. Everybody's going to think this is really cool. Like, well, thank you. Yeah, thank you. So, I am going to jump ahead now. Let me, yeah. So.